Hello, Minnesota. My name is Tony Hernandez, and welcome to the Tony Hernandez Show. Today is Groundhog's Day, February 2nd, 2013. I'm so glad that you're with me right here, right now. I'd ask you to tune in. We're broadcasting live every Saturday from 4 o'clock until 5 o'clock p.m. from the SCC Television Studios in White Bear Lake. We have a great show today. We're going to be talking to Colin Lee, who is an electric car enthusiast. We're going to be talking about electric cars, the electric car market, and really what is the future of electric cars right here in Minnesota and across our nation and worldwide. After that, we're going to be talking to Jim Carson, who recently announced his candidacy for the Congressional District 4 chairman right here in the 4th District. And finally, I'm going to bring on Jake Duesenberg, and we're going to talk about issues surrounding guns, violence. We're going to talk about the economy, federal finances, and more. So first of all, I just have to say happy Groundhog's Day. And it is true. Dallas, you want to put up the picture? It's true. It's Groundhog's Day. And Punxsutawney, did I pronounce that right? Phil has made his prediction. He says to expect an early spring. Thank God for that. With thousands of people watching on Gobbler's Knob in West Central Pennsylvania, the furry rodent emerged from his lair Saturday, but he did not see his shadow. And that's good news for all of us living in Minnesota, because for the last couple weeks, it has been freezing cold, reaching double digits below zero with the windshield and everything like that. So really good news coming out of Pennsylvania. Looking forward to spring coming very soon. Next, I want to give an update. We had Indy from our basketball team. I coach fifth grade basketball at St. Mark's grade school, and we were in the St. Peter's Catholic tournament last weekend, and I'm happy to say that we won second place. You know, we really tried hard, and all the kids wanted to win the championship, but as you can see by the picture there, they were all super happy, super excited, except for one of the kids who was crying after the game, was sitting next to me. But everybody had a great time, and you know, we learned that you don't always win the championship, but if you try hard and do your best, that second place isn't so bad. And following that, we have a couple more stories that we're going to be covering. Last week it was announced that Minnesota native Dennis McDonough, he's from Stillwater, Minnesota. You can see him in the picture right there shaking President Obama's hand. He was named the chief of staff of the Obama administration. And that's newsworthy because, A, we're all from Minnesota, so it's pretty cool to have a Minnesota guy being named into that position. He's from Stillwater. He was a big football player. He played under John Gagliardi in St. John's. So we congratulate him on that. But we also want to make our viewers aware a little bit more about his record because, you know, as a conservative in St. Paul and in Ramsey County, sometimes our voice gets washed out and we get typecasted, or we have the debate framed in certain ways. And, you know, one thing that I hear over and over again from my friends is that they support President Obama because they believe that he is an anti-war president. And his appointment of Dennis McDonough actually shows otherwise. And you'd actually have to search a little bit to find out what I'm talking about. But Dennis McDonough, he used to work for Senator Tom Daschle, who is the Democrat senator from South Dakota. And Mr. McDonough was instrumental in drafting the authorization of use of force in Iraq, in Afghanistan. He pushed for it. He promoted it. And you remember candidate Obama, Senator Obama, was staunchly against the Iraq war. And now he's choosing McDonough to head up his administration. So I find a little bit of hypocrisy in there. And I just wanted to make you, the viewers, aware, because we have to fight back and push back against some of these stereotypes that are out there. So finally, big day tomorrow is the Super Bowl. What are you going to be doing? I failed dramatically today. I was going to make guacamole, and I opened all my avocados, and guess what? They were all brown, so no guacamole tomorrow. But I want to wish this gentleman that you're looking at right now, his name is Matt Burke. He is a St. Paul native. He went to Nativity grade school, Cretan Durham High School, and he went to Harvard. I actually worked with him for a couple summers at MRL Company in Minneapolis. He is an all-American great guy. He is a hard worker, He is a smart, intelligent person. He's a great role model for kids. And most importantly, he's a Minnesota native and St. Paul native. So I hope everybody is going to be rooting for Matt Burke and the Ravens. Go Ravens. So I'd like to welcome our first guest to the show. His name is Colin Lee. Colin, thank you very much for being on.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
So Colin and I, we're going to discuss electric cars, the future of the electric car market. Colin is an electric car enthusiast. He's a good friend of mine as well. So Colin, let's just start.
Sure.
I want to hear a little more about the history of Colin Lee's ownership of vehicles. I want to start your first car. When was it?
During high school, senior, we got my first Plymouth Econo box. Drove that thing all the way through, high school. And went through a series of cheap, dying cars that were, six-figure mileage, of course. When I finally got a chance to buy my own car, I bought myself a Subaru Impreza.
When was this? What year?
Thinking 2002.
Okay.
Yeah. And, that thing was wonderful for me. It got me everywhere I needed to be. But more importantly, I was able to make a hobby of off-road racing, rallycross, as they call it. Taking it out on dirt tracks and that kind of thing. I became kind of a car enthusiast, someone who liked to, I would put on those big races where they had Travis Pastrana and, Ken Block and all the big names you've probably heard of. So I was a very enthusiastic rally racer, but I also saw this thing going on with the electric cars. I saw it when I was in college and the Saturn EV1 was just starting up. I saw one of those things. I thought that was absolutely incredible. The early reviews were stunning. Celebrities were saying, sure, this thing only goes 60 or 70 miles, and it weighs, about 2 tons. But the thing was, they loved their cars. They couldn't have enough of them, and they had the best maintenance records of any cars out there at the time.
So you were introduced to this particular vehicle then at an auto show?
No, actually, I heard about it online, and I looked into it. It wasn't until years later I saw Who Killed the Electric Car. A lot of people know the film.
I've seen that documentary, yeah.
It was, that really reminded me of what I was feeling at the time about the car.
And what was it that you were feeling? Like, can you describe that a little more?
Innovation. I mean, as someone who values, I'm an engineer. I make software for a living. I like to use the latest and greatest. I always have to have the newest gadget. I got to on order a, Nexus 4 phone. Everything, I love pushing the limit, trying to always be ahead of the curve. For example, we did a hackathon recently. I can't tell you what we did, but we won the whole thing, beating 45 other teams.
Wow.
With a new technology that I can't talk about.
So basically, though, you've always been inspired by technology, innovation, moving things forward, and that's kind of what caught your interest with this particular vehicle then?
Absolutely. I think it was the technological innovation, the fact that so many people are, want to be at the bleeding edge and trying this stuff, and what they're finding is they're very amazing cars. They're very different experience.
So can you talk a little more now going forward with your experience, the next car that you owned?
Okay, so after I got my Subaru, I did for a short time of a Nissan Sentra also in the household, which I'm selling. Now I moved on to a Nissan Leaf. I picked this thing up in June of 2012. But that's not the beginning of the story, because they put them on order in April of 2010. In one day, they said that they would open up the reservations. And in 6 hours, all 2,500 reservations were filled up.
Wow.
So for 2 years straight, we were waiting for our cars. I literally had $100 sitting at a Nissan facility somewhere waiting on the car. So we were a little stunned when we found out, between the natural disasters in Japan and other preparations for cold weather, that they held the car off that long in Minnesota. I was in the waiting list forever.
So you had to put a $100 deposit down, that's it?
Yeah, it was a $100 deposit, but I had to wait for 2 years and a couple of months.
Okay, so this is back in 2010 that you put the deposit down. And
correct.
So you finally got the car when?
June of 2012.
June of 2012. So you've owned it for about 6-7 months, something of that sort?
That's about right, yeah.
So can you just describe, when you got the car and the whole process of getting it and how you felt?
Well, that's the interesting part. You know, getting the car was always, you know, a lot of guesswork. They're always, you know, changing the dates on when they're going to arrive. But when it finally showed up at the dealer, they had to treat it a little differently because they've never touched one of these things before. I mean, an electric car.
Mm-hmm.
They had to make sure all the repair staff were trained. They wouldn't, you know, sell it without having enough chargers at the dealership. They literally had this long training program that people had to go through for months before they were able to sell the cars. I think part of that training program is, you know, ribbing the customer because they sold me on getting a free oil change with my car.
Nice. So you pick up the car.
Yep.
And talk about the first time you started it up and drove it off.
Well, obviously, the first time I started it up was before I even got to, you know, buy it because, and it was silent. I mean, the only noise you hear is a slight little whistle because it's they don't want people who are blind or with their heads turned to get run over, you know, as you absentmindedly, you know, ride right over them. They can't hear you in a parking lot, period, without the noisemaker under the hood, and it's very, very quiet.
Wow. But so it's similar to a golf cart then? Same thing? Or
it's much faster. You're not going to get a golf cart up to 95 miles an hour.
Mm-hmm. But I'm talking about the sound, though.
Right.
Essentially
right.
Silent.
Similar sound to a golf cart, yes.
Okay. And so you drove it off? And
yeah. I drove it off. It took off fairly fast. I mean, for a car that only gets 100 horsepower, electric cars have a lot of torque. Notoriously, you know, they have plenty of torque, which you'd think would make them good for towing, but you'll kill your range doing that. But they actually take off fast, very fast off the line. And they always seem to have regenerative braking. Everything about them is, it's kind of comfortable to have all of that technology around you at all times. Everywhere in this car, it'll read your news headlines to you off your RSS feed. They've just put all the latest and greatest technology into a car.
Wow. So is this your primary car then that you drive to and fro?
Yep.
Every single day?
I had a negative campaign attack on that one, actually. Someone claimed that because I had too many cars in my driveway that I was faking it or something. I've got 8,800 miles in my car, so you can do the math. In 7 months, that's, you know, my primary car.
Mm-hmm. Well, so if you're driving it as your primary, did you drive it here today?
I did.
You did from?
From Lakeville.
From Lakeville. So from Lakeville to White Bear Lake, that's a pretty good jaunt. It's back and forth, what is it, about 40 miles or so?
I think 45-ish.
45?
Yeah.
And so when are you going to, like, have to charge it up again? Is it going to be kanked out by the time you get it back? Or
I'll probably stop somewhere on the way home.
Really?
Yeah, it's not a big deal. It's most of the chargers, you know, the thing that people don't understand when they're looking at electric cars, they think about it like they think about a gas car.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where is the gas station? You know, why can't I just pull into a Citgo or a, you know, Amoco or whatever, whatever they're called these days, BP,
mm-hmm.
fill it up, leave. What they've done is they've put all of the places to fill up at, you know, shopping malls, places where you would go to buy groceries, places where you're going to spend time, maybe watch a movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I can drive to the Mall of America, drop my car, go shop for a few hours, walk back, and it's filled up.
Wow. So at the Mall of America, see, and I don't know this, at the Mall of America, they have electric stations in every one of the major parking lots, or do you have to search around for them? Or
they're actually in very primo spots. They're fourth floor of the parking ramp on each side. They have two stations, which technically could handle four cars if they had to. But, you know, people fill up those spots so fast next to the ones with signs that you wouldn't get more than two there.
And I take it there's a sign there that says for electric car parking only?
Correct.
And do you ever have issues trying to find one of these places? Or is that a fear in the future, is that there might not be enough of these stations?
We're already getting to a point where we're filling up the spots in mm-hmm. Minnesota. And that's amazing because Minnesota was so late to get electric cars.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, California is light years ahead of us in that sense. That everybody wants to have one now. They've all seen their friends driving them. They know it's a regular experience. And I think once it becomes normalized, it just takes off on its own.
Sure. Kind of. Well, Dallas, do you want to put up the graph? We have a graph here. There's a picture of the car. But I wanted to show a graph as well that we have. It shows the sales of hybrid or just electric vehicles. I don't know if that's totally legit of what you're talking about, Colin.
Yeah.
But it starts in 2000 and goes into 2012. And it looks,
10.
Or 2010, and it looks like at the beginning, mm-hmm. what is there, around in 2000, how many cars are sold
about,
there?
About 10,000.
About 10,000 cars, and it peaks in 2007, which mm-hmm. is when gas prices really started to soar.
Right.
How many was it there?
350,000.
350,000. And now it looks like that we're on a downward trend in terms of consumers who are out there, they're buying. So I wanted to mm-hmm. see if you could comment a little more about the market demand.
Right, right.
Why do we see that enormous upswing right away and now it's starting to trickle down again? Can you explain that in any way?
Well, whenever you're talking about statistics or numbers, the devil's in the details. When you're looking at a chart like that, what you're seeing is the economic downturn. It's 2007, 2008, we all know, is when the housing market collapsed and everybody had no job. Well, not everybody, but... enough. But what's more interesting here is this is just hybrid electric vehicle sales. If you mm-hmm. look at the first 4 years, there's mm-hmm. about 50,000 cars sold,
mm-hmm.
including the Prius, including the Honda Insight and all the other hybrids, only 50,000 the first 4 years. Mm-hmm. Last year was the second full year that we've had electric vehicles, plug-in electric vehicles on the road. And they sold 50,000 volts this year.
Wow.
So
that's pretty incredible.
So they've already exceeded in 1 year what they did in the first four years of hybrids. Mm-hmm. And I think that's because people have seen that the new technologies are not as scary as they mm-hmm. might be.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think in Minnesota, they're a little more afraid to go whole hog from the Volt to the Leaf and go with something that's pure battery because there's something called range anxiety. People feel like they're not going to make it to their destination because they have long trips, you know, that kind
yeah.
of thing.
Do people bring spare batteries, or is it just you get one battery per car?
You can buy aftermarket kits. Mm-hmm. I don't know anyone who has yet. I think most people just get used to the idea that if they want to go longer ranges, they need to find chargers near where they're headed to.
Mm-hmm.
The most common solution to that is workplace charging. You get your employer to say, oh, I'll put in the charger, you know, because I know it's a good perk. It helps, you know, encourage people to do the right thing in terms mm-hmm. of both energy and the environment.
Mm-hmm. And this is a probably silly question, but I assume that mm-hmm. there's a charger at your work place?
No, there isn't.
There isn't, huh?
No, I go to work, I park it there, and I drive straight home.
So that gives you enough juice to get back and forth then?
I've got plenty. It's 17 miles each way. So.
Nice. So, I mean, you've owned it now. You've been driving this thing for a while. Do you find any inconveniences? Are you ever like, oh, gosh, I wish I just had a gas car?
Well, there's been jokes on like Fox News and that. Tremor, who, not Brit Hume, the Hannity probably, going on about, you know, marriages are going to be lost over electric cars, he said, that over plug-in electrics. And he was saying that, you know, the husband will tell the wife, you know, you forgot to plug it in, and they'll say, no, you did it, and it would all fall apart. That hasn't happened, but we certainly have at times left a car on the street or you know, not plugged in overnight. And then I end up basically driving to the dealer and catching a shuttle to work. You
mm-hmm.
know.
And how about, in your opinion, in Minnesota, are we a fairly good state in terms of having fuel or the electric stations? And
we have fewer electric stations than average, actually.
We do.
But if you're in the right area, like St. Paul is especially far ahead of some of the other areas, then there are quite a number of chargers out there.
So these tend to be things that are handled then on the city level opposed to the mm-hmm. state level government? Or
that's not necessarily true. I have heard that the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency is considering grants potentially,
mm-hmm.
But most of it is done on either a city level or more likely even done by a company or you know, that wants to encourage more business. I mean, it makes sense. Think about this. You know, if Costco wants more customers to shop there, the most energy I can use in one shopping trip is about 25, 50 cents, but I'll spend $100 there.
Mm. Well, hey, Colin, would you mind entertaining a question that we have from somebody in our viewing audience?
Sure, I'd be glad to.
Hello, caller. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Okay. The question I have is, how much is the government subsidizing these cars and the electricity, and what's the government's contribution to these cars, or the taxpayers' contribution, I should say?
Yeah.
Sure. Thank you for the call.
All right,
do you
want to
address that, Colin?
I'd be glad to. Currently, the taxpayer contribution from federal government is about $7,500 per car.
Okay. So you essentially just get a tax
credit.
Credit. So when you bought your car, how much did you buy it for?
It would have been $37,000, and I would have gotten $7,500 off of that.
Okay, and then do you literally get a check for $7,500, or do you, when you file your taxes, it's credited that way?
You file your taxes and you get a credit.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
And the thing about that is that the energy itself is not subsidized by the government. In fact, it's mostly we're getting off-peak energy because you charge at night. You know, you put your car in your garage and you forget about it. Most people say, you know, how long does it take you to charge your car? You know, 20 seconds. How long does it take me to plug the thing in? And that's how long it takes. But, you know, the thing about the subsidies is that every electric car we put on the road results in lower fuel costs for everyone and lower electricity costs because you're buying off-peak energy that goes to waste. And that money goes to more infrastructure upgrades for your electric company. It means that they can afford, if you paid the real price of electricity from 4 p.m. to 9 p.m., you would be paying 30 or 40 cents a kilowatt hour. But you're not paying that. You're paying an averaged out number that everyone, you know, pays instead.
And how about, are there any tax credits available from the state of Minnesota?
Minnesota doesn't have one. California and Georgia do. Actually, Texas tried to get one, and Texas Governor Rick Perry was a strong supporter of it, wanted to give $5,000 in his state. So a number of Republican states have actually aggressively pushed these.
And do you see that changing in Minnesota? Do you see any, are there any bills moving forward right now that would?
I think the main push in Minnesota right now is to get the charging infrastructure. Minnesota is a state where more people, it's colder, you know, so you have a range reduction from the cold, essentially. And it's also longer distances between places. We don't have a lot of major cities, you know, where you can stop every 100 miles or so and find a charger. So I think that the legislative pressure right now is entirely to get more charging infrastructure, not so much grants. Although, you know, it would be interesting to see carpool lane access. I mean, what they've done that in other states, it doesn't cost much. It means that people are incentivized to buy the cars, but they don't have to spend a lot as a state to get people that incentive.
Well, that's very interesting, and I certainly appreciate you coming on the show, Colin, and telling the audience and teaching us a little more about electric cars. I find it fascinating, and I do believe we're going to see more and more of these types of cars in the future. So thanks for educating on this, and thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right. This way. Sorry.
That was Colin Lee, electric car enthusiast, good friend of mine, resident of Lakeville. It's really interesting to hear him talk about his own personal experiences with the electric car, you know, what he's doing with it, some of the ups and some of the downs to it, and tax credits from the federal government to purchase automobiles are not unique. You remember President Bush was famous for having tax credits for buying Hummers, H2 Hummers. And so I think if there are market, if there's a market out there that wants to purchase electric vehicles and there's a niche for it, I say let's go for it, let's develop it. And it's clean and it does good things. So our next guest that's gonna be coming on is Jim Carson. And Jim recently announced at the 43 BPOU convention that he is going to be running to be the chairman of Congressional District 4. Congressional District 4 is primarily Ramsey County and about half of Washington County. It's everything from St. Paul to Moundsview heading to Stillwater the other direction. There's about 750,000 residents that live in this area. The seat has been held by Representative Betty McCollum since 2000 is when she won, and it has not been won by a Republican since 1946. I know these statistics all too well, and hopefully we'll be able to do something to change that, because we need to make progress in this district. We've been getting walloped as of lately. We need to do some more things to change it. So we're going to hear from Jim about his perspective. So, Jim, thank you for coming on to the show.
Good to see you, Tony.
Appreciate it. Yeah, good to see you as well. And, you know, thank you as well for all your help with the campaign and everything that you did. You know, you were there at the meetings.
Experience.
And it was. It was a learning experience. Can you talk a little more about that experience and what we learned from it?
That Betty McCollum's is going to be hard to dislodge, but I don't think it's impossible. We need to have more money. We need him to have more resources brought into CD4 for that campaign, and we need to get some luck. That it's going to take that to defeat her, and she has made, from what I can see, no fatal mistakes. So, but that's not the case in a situation like with Mr. Oberstar. She will reach her Oberstar point at some point, and we will be ready for her.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, or the economy will tank as well, which be an opportunity.
That doesn't seem to have affected the electorate the way I would have thought it should have.
Mm-hmm.
This time. Mr. Obama's had his chance to fix the economy and has failed miserably. Unemployment is back up again. From the time he took office in 2009 till now, the unemployment rate's never fallen below the rate that when he took office, and he's accountable for that. And as is the rest of the Democratic Party.
Mm-hmm.
And they seem to be doing a pretty good job of blaming the Republican Party.
Mm-hmm. So why, in your opinion, are Republicans in the urban core in Ramsey County, Congressional District 4, why are we having such a hard time getting our message out and having the issues and the principles for which we stand resonate amongst the voters?
Well, as you know, I come from suburban Ramsey County, White Bear Lake, which is, in fact, I live about a mile and a half from here.
Nice.
And this is a district that's been represented in the House consistently by Republicans for a long time. And we have accomplished that in the past by a lot of hard work and spending a lot of money and having great candidates who fit the district and who do their job. The thing that I've been talking about for quite a few years is that we need to do a better job throughout the 4th Congressional District in order to raise our numbers. Some parts of especially the urban core, it's going to be very hard to win, or it's going to be, it's not going to happen. that doesn't mean we don't need to work hard to get our message across, because the party needs to do well in the urban core, or better than it is, in order to win statewide races. And so the conservatives in St. Paul need to show up to vote, even if they know they're voting for someone who's not going to go to St. Paul at the legislature. They need to show up because we have, electoral votes, or we have a U.S. Senate or governor or something like that, a race that needs to be won.
Mm-hmm.
A vote in St. Paul is the same as a vote in North Oaks. So if we do a better job, we will do in St. Paul and in the suburbs where we haven't really put out the best campaigns, mm-hmm. We will do better statewide.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the same is true in Minneapolis. Actually, it's probably more true in Minneapolis than in the area east of Minneapolis. So,
Well, let's talk a little more about the infrastructure of Congressional District 4. The legislators that have been elected, mm-hmm. in our district, we have State Senator Roger Chamberlain,
right,
who serves in your district.
Well, actually, he used to.
Oh, he's not anymore.
No, I got redistricted into Maplewood.
Okay.
I'm in that southern part of White Bear, the south of Cedar, that, I'm not going to characterize my feelings about that at this point. Not on TV.
So in CD4, we have State Senator Roger Chamberlain.
Right.
We have Representative Matt Dean.
Mm-hmm.
We have Representative Andrea Kiefer.
Yes.
There's, who else am I?
39.
Oh, we have Representative Kathy Lohmer.
Lohmer, Detmer, and...
Detmer and Housley.
Housley,
Senator,
right.
Housley.
Right. Those are what we have. And most of that, those folks were in the old 6th. Matt Dean lived in the old 6th, but even though his new territory was mostly in the old 4th.
Mm-hmm.
That's the lay of the land right now.
Mm-hmm.
We had a tough election night. I was confessed. I was very disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
We had a number of campaigns that put their heart and soul and every bone and gristle and brain into it, and still came up short.
Mm-hmm.
My district in 43A in particular, Stacey Stout came so close and yet came up a little bit short.
Yeah,
so.
She was a great candidate. She earned the endorsement from the Minneapolis Star Tribune, which
that was a shocker.
Pretty amazing that she did that, but she deserved it too, though.
Yes, she did.
She would have served the people well. Is she planning on running again? Have you heard anything from
her? I've talked with her several times, and I'm not, she hasn't made a decision yet as far as I can see.
Mm-hmm.
So it's there's a lot of time left too.
Mm-hmm.
on that, she's very interested in politics, having worked for government a lot, federal government for the most part, or in areas related to federal policy for her career. But you know, she was a wonderful candidate, and you're right, she would have served this district extremely well. She was a very able attorney, and would have done a great job.
I think that if she did decide to run again in 2014, I believe she would win.
Yes, I believe she would too. All we need is to not have a headwind.
Mm-hmm.
That was the thing that was surprising to me as a political activist. I didn't expect that we would have a headwind. I thought that we would have pretty much of a neutral environment, given we didn't. The Democrats did a better job of getting the vote out, getting their message micro-targeted, and so on. Looking at the debris from the election, they did a good job, which is itself surprising to me.
Did you attend the meeting Wednesday night at the Blue Fox?
Yes, I did.
What was the title of that meeting again?
Where to go from here?
Where to go from here?
Right.
I was not able to attend. I had some prior commitments, but can you summarize some of the good points that were made and where that applies to the 4th Congressional District? What we can learn from?
The good points were we had a number of the different, activists and factions and so on that aired what they saw from the election. I thought it came up short though for two reasons. One is that there were no money people on the panel to talk about the our money situation, which is, it's no secret that the state party is in some trouble. And the second problem was that they didn't seem to have any consensus. They didn't come to any kind of consensus. There was a lot of, flashing of swords and not a lot of a resolution of anything.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's people like myself and others, and like yourself too, who are going to go out and talk about these things over coffee or whatever your choice of beverage is,
mm-hmm.
and will decide, make some decisions and choices to which direction the party's going to go.
Mm-hmm.
I think for the first time I've ever seen openly, though, is the challenge to the social conservatives. That was a little surprising that it was that open,
mm-hmm.
On the challenge to the social conservative agenda.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that's because of the people that were selected for the panel, or do you think that that's actually an emerging?
Partly it's because of who was selected, and partly because it's an emerging question as to whether we have served ourselves and our state and the party well by focusing as much as we have on those items. The public is not paying attention to social issues right now. And when they do, it's not in ways that we want them to. The public's concerned about their wallet. I've been harping on this for the entire election. This is a money election. It's not about guns, babies, and gays. It's as much as I, I'm on their side on those issues. I am not aware that the public has any interest in those issues. They want to hear how we're going to solve our financial problems,
mm-hmm.
and not how we're going to deal with those social issues.
Mm-hmm.
Now the Democrats seem to have been very busy at trying to bring guns back into the equation. So maybe that'll change for 14, but I still don't think that the marriage issue and the abortion issue are going to figure in to the 2014 races, at least unless it's localized or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, there was that report that came out. I don't know if I read it on MinnPost or the Star Tribune, but they calculated that in totality, $18 million were spent on both sides on the marriage amendment. I think the majority of that being Minnesota United for All Families.
Right, the vote no people.
Mm-hmm. So, people may be concerned about the social issues, but we may be on the wrong side of the
I don't know that we're on the wrong side. I don't think the voter wants to hear about it.
Mm-hmm.
And that the vote no resonated because it should not have been on the ballot
yeah.
this time.
Well, that's actually a pretty important point, because one thing I did hear, I watched some of the video from the mm-hmm. event on Dallas's YouTube channel, MNCD4 mm-hmm. Conservative,
mm-hmm.
Which you can see the whole, I think it was 2 hours. But that is one point that was made by Andy Parrish. He said that the marriage amendment won in a great majority of the counties. And if you look at the different districts, it beat even the Democrats and the Republicans. And but I would say, though, that, that your point is well served, because I looked at the numbers in St. Paul, too. There are neighborhoods that voted close to 50% in favor of the marriage amendment. So I think the mistake Republicans make is they believe that they own the social issues, when in fact the social issues are independent of politics, independent of government, where they should be.
Well, as from the political perspective, I was active in of course, in White Bear Lake in the summer of last year, in June, during Market Fest, and I saw that the Vote No people were very active at Market Fest, which White Bear Lake is known for being a militantly moderate district. They don't like extremes. So, but people were allowing the Vote No people to put their stickers on their kids, on themselves. It was Vote No everywhere. I don't know what the result was in the election. I didn't look that up. But I could see that the mood of the city was not on the marriage. It was not to vote for the marriage amendment. And that was when my first inkling that this was a problem. Well, I was against it in the first place, putting it on the ballot in the first place, because, again, I thought this was going to be a money election and not a social issues election.
Well, let's get back to the nuts and bolts of CD4 and what we can do here to improve, to make ground, and perhaps pick up a couple seats in 2014. Can you share a little more about that?
Sure. The first goal that I have as chair is to make sure that all of the campaigns know what to do and when to do it, and have at least the, and have the resources to get the message to the door. That's a mechanics thing. It's also to some extent a money thing. The second goal, though, which was not on my agenda when I had been chair before, was we need to do a much better job on the in the minority communities, on reaching out to Hmong, the Somali, and the Hispanic communities in particular. Those are the three largest. I apologize if I'm missing anybody of the large communities. But we need to reach out to those communities and connect with them on an issues basis and on a values basis. They, in the discussions I've had with people in that fit that those profiles, they're with us here. But somehow the Democrats have managed to reach into their hearts and own that. And we need to change that. And I think we can. And it's, and that's going to be a major focus of my efforts when and if I'm elected as chair. And then the third thing we need to do is we need to do a better job on social media types of tools. That's a little more of a mystery, because it seems to me that the Facebook, Twitter, tools like that seem more like echo chambers, and that you're talking to your own people, not to people outside of your group, but people are telling me otherwise, that I respect, and so I want to explore that as a institution and to do a better job there. So those are the three things on my, you know, agenda. And we also need to raise a lot more money. The state party is flat on its back right now. In fact, the state Democrat party is also flat on its back. It's having financial problems too. They're not as public about them. And so it's going to fall to the local parties and the congressional district parties to take that up and take up the mantle of leadership and make sure that these things happen.
And, you know, going back to another point, too, when I was watching the event from last Wednesday, Andy Parrish did make one great point, I believe. And he was talking about specifics in terms of micro-targeting, BPOUs, having a database that's well-maintained and shared. And one frustration that I had from the previous campaign is there's no continuity from campaign to campaign to campaign. I think the only thing that was handed to me, they weren't lists, they were just rebar to hang the signs up. That's about...
Don't underestimate the value
of
rebar.
Yes, it's worth money.
And, it's worth a lot of money.
They cost money, and to chop that rebar up is a very dirty and onerous task. But, you know, at the same time, what can we do in the fourth to better document our neighborhoods, to better ID who the independents are, who the conservatives are, who the Democrats are, so that when we're calling on phone lists and whatnot, we're not calling people who would never, ever, ever vote on the Republican side?
Well, there's a lot of problems with list management. We used to do a lot better job. I was heavily involved with the data on the 2002, 2004, and 2006 elections, and our data was of much higher quality at that time. We used to do micro-targeting quite effectively, and it made the difference, especially in 2004. It made the difference in a number of races to push people over the top. The problem is that we've been switching around so much on which database we're using. We're spending all of our time talking about software, not enough time talking about data. Mm-hmm. And so we need to change that. We need to just stick with whatever decisions we've made and work on developing the data. We also need to find new ways of developing the data itself. The era of phone calls and, you know, asking people surveys and stuff like that, that's pretty much been wrung out. Mm. And we need to find other ways of determining what people believe. Also, we need to work more on what they believe in terms of issues and in terms of their identification, and less on their party identification. Because especially in the 4th District, we need to cobble together a coalition of Republicans, independents, and some Democrats. We don't need to win a majority of the Democrats, but we need to win some Democrats in order to win an election. We can't ignore Democrats mm-hmm. in our campaigns, and I never have in the campaigns that I've run and been involved with. We go after the Democrat vote. We do fairly well with it. You know, Chamberlain's campaign in particular, we were very aggressive in going after the fiscally conservative Democrats. They mm-hmm. and Rogers' message resonated with them. We made sure that they heard from us, and he won. And he won re-election. Although I had very little to do with his campaign, and I just did some lit dropping for him mm-hmm. In 2012. But still, we need to think about the Democrats not as the enemy. Some of them are our friends. And so if some of the Democrats in St. Paul would be Republicans if they lived out in White Bear or Forest Lake.
Mm-hmm. So quickly, Jim, because we have to continue on with the show, I just wanted to address one thing just so people know. Mm-hmm. I know you had some health issues in the past. And
yep,
How are you feeling now? Are you fully recovered? And
No. I had, in 1st of October, came down with a staph infection, spent a week in the hospital, and then went through the whole, you know, IV antibiotics for a month. And then at Thanksgiving morning, in fact, I got a call from the nurse. They had done a blood culture because I hadn't been feeling right, and was in the hospital from Thanksgiving morning for another 5 days. And then I've been on a 24/7 constant IV antibiotic that I just got rid of, got finished with that. And then now I've got 6 months of pills. So
Is it going to affect your ability to serve as a chairman?
No, not at all. Wouldn't have affected even with the IV antibiotics. It just simply would have, it wouldn't have been able to do some of the things I like to do. Mm-hmm. But as far as running meetings and stuff, I think I did okay when I wasn't in the hospital, working with your campaign and with others. So this is not the first time either that I've run into a health issue during a campaign. In 2006, I was struck by Guillain-Barré and was actually nearly died. Hmm. Bounced back and was involved in the 2006 races too. Seems that when I get sick, the party does very, very poorly though, which is,
hope you feel better.
Me too.
Thank you so much for being on the show, Jim.
Thanks very much.
Jim will help you with the microphone and everything. So thank you again. Jim Carson, running for the 4th Congressional District Chair. Certainly know that he's a hard worker. He's dedicated to the cause, the conservative cause. I've seen him in action with multiple campaigns, multiple people. We're going to bring on Jake Duesenberg next. First, I just wanted to address a couple polls that were recently let go. The public policy polling. They did some polling in Minnesota to talk about the 2014 races, in particular the Minnesota governorship and the U.S. Senate seat. So Governor Mark Dayton and U.S. Senator Al Franken, they are both up for re-election. And, you know, they do these polls, and a lot of people have criticized the public policy polling as decidedly Democratic, which may or may not be true. But with the Dayton, they say, you know, that he's leading every potential Republican candidate. They're reporting that Governor Dayton has a 53% approval rating and only 39% of people disapprove of the job that he's doing. They list some candidates, and it looks like right now, former U.S. Senator and St. Paul Mayor Norm Coleman seems like he may be the most likely foe. It said that 57% of Republicans polled say that they would like Norm Coleman to be the candidate who challenges Governor Dayton. The only other person that was closer to Dayton was Governor Pawlenty, but it's doubtful that Pawlenty's going to get back in the political scene. He's working in the private sector, doing well right now. But I find it interesting that they didn't poll a couple people, namely a good person would have been Tom Emmer, Representative Emmer, to really show a solid contrast as to where Dayton is, or where he was in 2010 to where he is going to be in 2014. But the public policy polling, they neglected to use Tom Emmer's name, which I think is just part of the bias that maybe they have in terms of skewing the numbers and painting the picture that the Democrats have it in the bag. It's always two years before, and they're like, you know, there's nobody that can come close to challenging them. Same thing with the U.S. Senator Al Franken race. They did another poll, and it says that he's in great shape, that nobody's even close. They polled Minnesotans, and, you know, Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann was above and beyond the number one choice for Republicans to run against U.S. Senator Al Franken. But again, you know, they did not include certain names. And again, for the governor race, too, another person that wasn't mentioned, and I believe on purpose, is former Representative John Creasel. And, you know, he is highly popular here in Minnesota. A lot of center left and independents and Democrats would probably vote for John Creasel, but he wasn't named nowhere in the polling. And, you know, he may or may not run. He hasn't denied that he's not going to run. So look for that in the future and take these polls with a grain of salt. So my next guest, Jake.
Good to see you, Tony.
Good. We reversed again. Last week you were wearing the suit and I was wearing more casual, and now I'm wearing the suit and you're going a little more casual. What gives?
Well, you called me and said to do the reverse this week.
That's right. I forgot.
I thought that was secret.
What do you think about those polls that I was just talking about, though?
With the... I agree with your idea. They're leaving out key people, especially in the Senate race. I'd like to see what Jason Lewis does, but none of that really matters. Public policy polling is not really the most credible source for polling, but, you know, these are incumbents. They're going to be up right now. There's no name recognition really out there for these challengers. So, yeah, I mean, I can't really dispute the fact that Al Franken's up on a couple nameless, or, well, a couple named people, but...
Yeah. Well, thanks for bringing up the Jason Lewis. I know that he is. I don't know if he's formally considering running for the governor, but I've heard rumors that
for Senate. Yeah, I would think Senate would be his.
That would be
his race. Yeah, I would estimate that.
But yeah, but he's another person that was neglected. He wasn't put in the polls. So
right.
But you know, either or, I think that, you know, he's a principled person. I think that he would serve the people, the interests of Minnesota very, very well in either the governorship or the U.S. Senate seat. So.
Yeah.
Definitely. What do we have going on for this week? We still have this debt ceiling debacle in place, and
that's always there.
We're still exceeding our debt limit, and
right.
We're kind of living in this gray area. We can't borrow anymore, but somehow, some way, they're finding ways to get the money out and paying our bills and whatnot.
Well, you didn't see they balanced the budget last week? You didn't see that?
No, I didn't.
Okay, no, they didn't even come close. No, it's the same old debate. I think we talked about it the last 2 weeks, and I don't know if we need to rehash that. It's the same old, overspending time and time after again. And, you know, they're not, there's really no fiscal conservatism out there other than a couple legislators, and we continue kicking the can down the road.
Sure. Well, let's just get into the topic at hand.
Sure.
We've kind of, you know, talked about federal finances a lot and the economy. And, you know, still to this day, one of the number one topics out there of discussion, whether it's on Facebook or Twitter, talk radio, TV or whatever, is the gun control,
sure.
Violence surrounding guns,
yep.
And what President Obama and Congress is or is not going to do in our Minnesota legislature. So, Dallas, you want to just pop up that that graphic right there? This was in the Huffington Post, and actually a friend of mine posted this, and I just thought it was interesting. The Huffington Post went and pictured, you know, they have 1,200 or so people, and these are all people, sadly and tragically, mm-hmm. that have died through somebody shooting them with a gun, yep. essentially. And about 1,200 people have been killed since Sandy Hook. And what this article is saying here is that, you know, the price of freedom, or our Second Amendment right to bear arms, has a cost, and that cost is these human lives.
Sure.
And I just wanted to get your take on this particular piece. And is this accurate?
Well, it might be accurate, and those are gun violence victims there, but that's a biased piece. Obviously, the crime rates or the murder rates with guns are higher in areas that are gun-free, so law-abiding citizens can't own guns or can't carry guns in that area. So you got capitals like D.C., Chicago, and then now New York, which is a high-crime area. So places that forbid law-abiding citizens to carry guns, those are where the majority of those pictures are probably from. And so really, that's not a freedom issue. It's more or less a, you know, fighting crime issue. Or even a restriction of freedom that's leading to that, as mm-hmm. I would argue.
Yeah, and I did go ahead and I read the article. And just for full disclosure, I do not own a gun. I've never owned a gun. Okay. I have shot a gun before in high school, actually. I went to St. Thomas Military Academy, and we had a shooting range in the basement of the school. And I shot a .22 and actually earned, like, one of the highest marksman things
Good.
You could get.
Yeah.
So, you know, I certainly understand the founder's intent of
yep.
the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms, and I understand the arguments of why the citizenry should be allowed to carry arms. That being said, when I read some of the articles, or the article of the Huffington Post, you know, they talked about this one boy in particular. It was the day, Christmas Day, mm-hmm. and his dad had just bought a gun because they had been robbed a couple months prior to that. Mm-hmm. So the dad buys a gun, leaves the gun on the table, is talking on the phone with somebody. His poor son picks up the gun, and he mm-hmm. accidentally shot himself in the chest, and he died.
Yeah.
And he died on the way to the hospital. And I was reading this story. I was like, it broke my heart. They had a picture of this kid, cute, innocent, little
right.
boy, died really just from playing with a gun that was loaded that shouldn't have been there in the first place.
Right.
Is this just an emotional story
yes.
about, you know, why, you know, can you...
Yeah, absolutely. It's all emotions here. I own several guns. I have nephews and nieces that come to my place. I'm a responsible gun owner. There's been no accidents in my house. What people want to do is take away guns from a person like me that's responsible because of an irresponsible parent that left the gun open. It's like saying, since you didn't lock up the chemicals under your sink, then all of a sudden we need to ban chemicals. It doesn't make sense. Chemicals have a use. Guns have a use. We don't ban something because someone makes a mistake, take it away from law-abiding citizens. So
mm-hmm.
it's an emotional reaction to something that's really not the key problem here. It's really irresponsible parent. It's not a gun that's really the thing that's wrong.
Mm-hmm. Did that particular father, and I think he was from South Carolina, did he have to go through training classes
before he
had that gun?
But
in Minnesota,
you know,
can you describe the
process?
Well,
if you think about one of the greatest fatalities to Americans is on the highway, right? And, you know, you don't get behind a one-ton vehicle that can go 70 miles an hour and don't go through any training. We all go through training, driver's ed. It's the same thing with a gun. A person that wants to own a gun, because it is a dangerous tool if it's used in the wrong way, you should have some sort of training. I can't speak to it if he didn't, but the majority of gun owners do have some basic training, if not more thorough training. And that does happen here in Minnesota especially.
So that's something that you perhaps would agree to then in terms of restricting guns is a federal requirement for people to...
No. I don't believe we solve things at the federal level. I believe in the Constitution, and that's not overreaching like a federal program. What I believe in is responsibility of the citizens, and if we want to use a government force, then we use it at the local level. But no, I absolutely don't support some federal program. But what I do support is people being responsible and taking it amongst themselves to protect their family from careless incidents like what you were mentioning.
So you're telling me that President Obama, Senator Klobuchar, Congresswoman Betty McCollum, these people should not be getting involved in the gun debate at all. Congress should take no action at this point.
Right. They feel like they have to act because that's how they get reelected. They show that they care and people think they care. And I mean, they really don't care at all. They might care about taking away my guns, and I'm a responsible gun owner. It doesn't make sense. I rather see these issues solved at a local level. And I feel that way about almost every political issue other than national defense, which is just going to be a national issue.
Well, let's talk about the local level then.
Sure.
What is the state legislator of Minnesota doing, if anything, at this point?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, we've got a couple things, a piece of legislation. I brought in a chart. One bill that's been introduced this last week is to ban assault weapons. This is something that Obama and Biden have been pushing. Now, this is a state law, but also the federal legislators are thinking about this. So this first chart I brought in shows what they're talking about. They're talking about assault weapon or so-called assault weapon, and they call this a powerful weapon. All right. What I'm showing here on this chart is three different types of rounds. The one on the far left, the very small round, is the .223 round. That's a caliber. It's 0.223 inches. That's the diameter of the round. Very small, and as you can see, as we go to the picture on the bottom, the diameter compared to a 270, which is a common whitetail hunting round, it's very small, and especially when you look in the far right, a Western, big game round, a 300 Winchester Magnum, it pales in comparison. The smaller the round, the less gunpowder it packs, the less power that weapon has. So what the Minnesota legislature wants to do is ban that round on that far left side, or the weapons that shoot that round, and keep the other two intact because they don't want to go after hunting rifles. So what I showed is exactly what the heck an assault weapon is that they call it through legislation. So let's just take a typical hunting rifle. This is a Remington 750 that I've got pictured here. And this is a pretty common weapon or common firearm. If this is a semi-automatic rifle, which means that if you pull the trigger once, one bullet flies. It's different from an automatic that if you pull the trigger, it automatically keeps firing bullets. So if we take this weapon or this firearm here, and I keep saying weapon because I'm former infantry military, so it's common for me to do that. But if we take this firearm and we paint it black, and then we add one feature to it, like in this case, a pistol grip, it's also an assault rifle, but doesn't fire different and it shoots that same round. That's the small one on that chart I showed you.
So what are you trying to say then here?
I'm trying to say that these laws, they make it seem like these rifles are terrible, terrible weapons, mass-producing, powerful assault rifles. But really what it is just a typical hunting rifle that's painted black and has a cosmetic feature like a pistol grip. It doesn't make it any more dangerous than other rifles. And they obviously aren't telling the public that they're coming after hunting rifles, but a lot of these are used in hunting, these so-called assault rifles.
And there's further some more action to try to limit the amount of, can you explain that a little more?
On what?
The magazine.
Oh, limits. Magazines, yep. Another thing that they're trying to do right now is limit you to 7 rounds or below on your magazine. I brought a picture here of a typical medium-sized to full-size handgun, and this would be something that gets banned through the legislation that was introduced.
So this anything above 7 shots then would be illegal.
Right. Yep.
And many people, I'm assuming, in Minnesota own.
Many people. This is a very common self-defense weapon.
So what would be expected for them to do? Melt their gun or hand it over to the feds?
I believe what they need to do is they need to turn it in or get it out of state or turn it into law enforcement is what the law says.
Interesting. Yeah. Well, I can't believe we're almost out of time on our show. I do want to have you back next week because I want to talk more about the mental health.
Sure.
Aspect of what people are talking about and some of the unforeseen consequences that may occur. People are jumping on the bandwagon. Yeah, we should do a mental health screening, but little are they forgetting that if you look at people's medical records, 30 to 50% of people have had medical issues at some point in time in their life. So please join us next week, Saturday, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock p.m. We're broadcasting live every day. Thank you.